It is my distinct pleasure now to welcome to the podium Senator Graham, who really does define needing no introduction. But Senator Graham, since 2002, you've been a leading voice in the Senate on all of the issues we've been talking about today.
See how well that's worked out.
Yeah, right. But so we're delighted to welcome you here today. And have a conversation. We've been talking here all day long about foreign policy challenges. I know you've just returned from a trip to various parts of the world, and some of which we've been talking about. And you've also been an important voice on how we need to think about winning the war on terrorism. And you held a hearing last spring and into the summer where you said that we're not going to win this war by just killing terrorists, and this is a crisis where you pay now or pay later. That theme was echoed a bit this morning, both by Admiral Stavridis and Secretary John Kerry, who talked about the Marshall Plan and how we need to ensure that we're thinking about all of our 3Ds working together. So, love to hear your thoughts on that.
Anybody here not being confirmed this week, raise your hand. We're having like 400 hearings. Tell Jeff Sessions he's doing great. One, thanks to the Institute. Beautiful building, great cause. You get some taxpayer dollars, good investment. Steve bugs the crap out of me all the time about more money. But
Thank you, Steve.
Hadley, yeah. So what's the theme of this thing, passing the baton?
Yes.
I hope that's what we pass is a baton. The first thing I think President-elect's got to do is find out in his own mind, what is winning the war on terror? I mean, we know what World War II was like. You take Berlin, you take Tokyo, you shoot down the Air Force, you sink their Navy. I think it's been hard for Americans to get their heads around what we're doing. We are very schizophrenic. When we get attacked, we want to blow everybody up. After about 2 or 3 years, we want to leave everybody alone. It won't work that way. When you get attacked, you need to respond, but you also need to respond in a fashion to make sure you're not attacked again. So I think the big problem he's going to have in his own mind is, how do you win the war? And what does winning look like? Let me tell you what I think winning looks like. People over there can take care of their problems with some of our help, but not be dependent upon us. Their armies and their police forces can protect the populations, and the rule of law replaces the rule of gun, and young people have something to live for rather than die for. That's pretty nebulous, but when you think about it, defeating radical Islam is the proposition that they're selling a glorious death, we got to sell a hopeful life. And if I could find a way to win this war where all of us stayed over here and never had to go over there, I would. So I'd rather fight it in their backyard than ours. I'd rather have partners than do it alone, and I'd rather hit them before they hit us. And to win the war, the kinetic part of it has limited utility. What have I learned after 39 trips to Iraq and Afghanistan? It's a long-ass way over there. And I keep running into the same people all the time who are fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan. The 1% have been doing a heck of a job on our behalf. So what have I learned? That building up their institutions is hard, particularly when there's lack of security. And I hope President-elect Trump, soon to be President Trump, will understand that if you're not for the 150 account, which all of you know, right? It's good to talk to an audience who knows what the 150 account is. We didn't fill up the room. It's probably for a reason. So I'm going to try to convince him and General Flynn that the 150 account is a great tool in the war on terror, and that you want to rebuild up the military. Replacing sequestration is a great place to start. But if you don't replace sequestration for the FBI, the CIA, the National Security NSA and the 150 account, you'll miss the boat on what it takes to win the war. So the president-elect's got to make a decision in his own mind. What is our role in winning the war, and what does victory look like?
The earlier panel was talking about the importance of investing precisely in those areas of great instability that have the potential to come back down the road to be a greater problem. Would you agree with that?
Yeah. So the Marshall Plan, have y'all been talking about that? The reason we made that name up is we couldn't think of another name. Most people my age understand what the Marshall Plan was all about. It was taking totalitarian states with radicalized populations, staying until things got better, building up the very buildings you blew up, working with the kids that the prior regime tried to radicalize, and over the arc of time, you got Germany and Japan. Let me tell you, it is pretty hard right now in this environment selling staying power. So the 150 account is 1% of the budget. My belief is that if we could create a new account where Western democracies, Gulf Arab states, Japan, and it'd be ironic if Germany led the new Marshall Plan, and put together about $100 billion, and said to developing nations, we're here to help you, but there's going to be a new way of doing it. Nigeria, we got to get Nigeria right. So you got a new president, they're taking the fight to Boko Haram. So what I would envision with this money is a public-private partnership like the Millennium Challenge Corporation, what President Bush should be very proud of. So it's going to be an international version of that. It will be new money, not to replace the UN, not to replace individual state aid programs, but a collaborative effort between the private sector and the public sector to take new money and leverage better results. In some countries, it may be power. For us to help you with your power supply, you can actually pass laws where people have to pay the power bill. So the bottom line is, I'm trying to convince the new administration and my Republican colleagues that we're going to pay now or we're going to pay later. And the worst nightmare for radical Islam is for us to get to the country before they do, invest in the lives of the young people before they can corrupt their lives. And the biggest antidote to terror above all else is giving a poor young girl a chance for an education and a voice for her children. That drives these guys nuts. And that's what I want to do.
Exactly. Thank you. Thank
you. And help Israel.
You know, you mentioned that it takes a long time to solve these problems, and that's been one of the themes today, is that these...
That's why it helps to take Senator Thurman's place. You have a long view of things.
And we've been talking about how these are not problems that are solved in 4 or even 8 year increments. And it's actually the 70th anniversary today of a speech that Senator Vandenberg gave 70 years ago. We made the very famous line that politics stop at the water's edge. So in order to transcend these 4 to 8 year increments, we really do need this bipartisan support for key foreign policy solutions. You've had a long, successful career. Is that still possible? Is that imperative still front and center?
Well, it's okay to disagree about foreign policy, too. It's okay to have robust debates, but you don't want to undermine each other. So let's look at what President Trump's going to have to deal with. We're going to take Mosul back from ISIL. How many of you think we'll eventually do that? Raise your hands. Ramadi, Fallujah, how do you hold them? Raqqa's going to fall one day. Who's the holding force? It's my view that the YPG Kurds are not going to hold Raqqa, that you're going to need an Arab holding force. And if you've been to any of these areas lately, you realize that the entire economy's been devastated. Would he leave a residual force behind this time? The first question he's going to have to answer in my mind is he willing to put American dollars into the pipeline to reconstruct these cities that have been destroyed in the name of liberating them? And will he get other people to put money in the same pot? Because if you don't invest in reconstructing Mosul, Ramadi, and Fallujah, they're going to fall back into the enemy's hands. A residual force. If the Iraqis requested this time around a residual force, which they did last time, by the way, would he say yes? Here's my advice. If you don't leave some soldiers behind this time, you're going to get the same result as last time. Syria. Who's going to hold Raqqa and that part of Syria? Is this a good deal that the Russians and the Iranians? Here's my general proposition. Any deal cooked up by the Russians and the Iranians is probably not a good deal. So what have they accomplished? They've driven us out of Syria in terms of peacemaking. And if Assad stays in power, I hope the president-elect understands that that will be a recruiting tool for radical Islam for decades. The biggest winners, I think, of the Russian-Iranian-Turkey deal is Russia, Iran, Assad, radical Sunni Islamic groups. The biggest losers, Syrian people, us, the Arab neighbors, and eventually Turkey, and maybe Israel. Why did I say Israel? Israel's constantly under attack from two groups. One's Hamas, one's Hezbollah. The last thing I want, Ron, for your country is to have somebody in power in Damascus that would create a corridor all the way into Lebanon so that the weapons that exist in Syria can flow into Lebanon and one day be used against your country. To our friends in Turkey, if you think this is a good deal for you, you're very short-sighted. What is Erdogan's political base? What is it? It's the rural areas of Turkey. The secular urban areas, not so much. Here's what I fear. By throwing in with Russia and Iran, he's reinforcing the narrative that he's empowered the mortal enemy of Sunni Islam, the Iranian Ayatollah, and that radical Islam is going to descend upon Turkey with a vengeance. Not because Turkey helped destroy ISIL, but because Turkey will be seen by religious conservative people who are not members of ISIL or Al-Qaeda as having done a deal with the devil. So this current construct of where Syria is given into three groups, Turkey gets a foothold inside of Syria to deal with this Kurdish problem. I think it's not going to help the Kurdish problem. I think it's make it worse. Why did Turkey do this? I think Turkey believed that we were an unreliable partner because we were training the Kurds as the liberating holding force. In the eyes and minds of the average Turkish government official, the YPG Kurds and the PKK are every bit as lethal as ISIL and Al-Qaeda. I think we drove them to the Russian-Iranian camp. Here's what President Trump's got to decide. He's publicly said he wants to work with Russia to destroy radical Islam. They're not destroying radical Islam. They've been destroying the moderate forces that have been trying to liberate the country from Assad. If he insists that Assad stay in power, if President Trump buys into that construct, I think it's going to be a nightmare for the Arab countries surrounding Syria because the war never ends. I think it'll be a problem for our friends in Israel. And I think Turkey's in a world of hurt. When he wants to build up the military, count me in. Is he willing to invest in the 150 account? Because if he's not, then I think we're missing the whole point of trying to win the war. Does he want to leave forces in Iraq when everybody's ready to leave? Will he build up forces in Afghanistan? He's going to have a lot of hard decisions. Will he give more money to Israel? I hope so. I want to help him, and I hope everybody in here will want to help him. But the bottom line is, when I think he's wrong, I've got to have the courage of my convictions, even though I'm a Republican, to tell my party I think you're wrong.
Senator Graham, you have been a longtime supporter of the UN. However, you've been quite critical recently since the vote on Israel. And I'm curious whether you see that there might be other ways to address what was essentially a political vote of member states without undermining the importance of the UN.
I'm an internationalist in my party. I'm a Steve Hadley kind of guy. So I think what President Bush did with PEPFAR and all the AIDS programs in Africa is going to serve us well for 100 years. The United Nations, the Marshall Plan has to be coordinated with what the UN's already doing. I've already met with the new Secretary General before he got the job. Great guy from Portugal. Can't say his name, don't want to butcher it. But how do I sell to the people in South Carolina that I want to take more of your tax dollars, partner with international organizations that in their mind have gone crazy? The average South Carolinian believes that when it comes to our national security and the problems in the world, Israel's not the biggest problem. To those who believe that it's about land, you really don't remember very well what happened when Israel left Gaza. How do you do peace when you have the other side divided into two camps? I believe in a two-state settlement, two-state solution, but it requires the ability of both parties to deliver if we reach an agreement. I'm going to suspend funding to the United Nations, being an internationalist, until they correct the problem with this resolution. We've had differences with our friends in Israel about settlements, but we've always said among ourselves, we're going to keep these differences among ourselves, and we're never going to let the United Nations take over the peace process. Here's my problem with what the United Nations did. They selectively chose one issue of many. They highlighted in a fashion that I think gives false hope to peace. The problem, as I see it, is not settlements by itself. It's the fact that Hamas governs about 40% of the Palestinian population, and they're not remotely interested in peace, and that Abbas can't deliver. So I'm going to do two things. Ted Cruz, my new best friend, we're going to introduce a resolution tomorrow suspending all assistance to the United Nations until we get this resolution in a better spot. Stop funding the Palestinian Authority until they change their laws that reward young Palestinians for killing Israelis and Americans. And let me give you an example. Taylor Force is a young man whose parents live in South Carolina. He graduated from West Point, did a tour of duty in Iraq and Afghanistan. He was in Israel as a graduate student, studying in Jaffa, I believe it was. Went out to dinner, came out of the restaurant, got stabbed to death by a Palestinian. The Palestinian was killed. His body was sent back to Ramallah. He was welcomed as a hero, given a state funeral. And his parents were given a lump sum of money by the Palestinian Authority. What am I supposed to tell people in South Carolina? I know Abbas well. He's got a lot of political problems. But I'm not going to continue to fund organizations who tell their young people the best way to get ahead is to kill somebody else. So how you doing?
Are there ways that leverage can be used with member states without imperiling, especially the critical assistance that the UN provides to a burgeoning
refugee? I had a healthy conversation with the Ukraine. They voted for this resolution. Like, what are you thinking? I went to eastern Ukraine with the president and looking at the Russians killing everybody. I said, yep, they're doing it. How would you like to be in Israel where you give up land voluntarily and you get 10,000 rockets? It's not that I don't see fault in our friends in Israel. There's fault with all of us. I just see this to be an absurd proposition by the international community to single out settlements and condemn Israel. I just don't see that as being very constructive. To the member states who voted for this and depend on us for assistance, we're going to have a new conversation here. Peace will come only when the Palestinians are united and can deliver. If that day comes where they have an election and they're long overdue, and the Palestinians reject Hamas and they vote for a more moderate view, then the burden will be on Israel. Until that day comes,
Senator Graham, we want to open the room to get some questions and reflections from the audience.
Absolutely.
So if anybody has anything they'd like to raise with the senator, and one of the, I'd like to also note that one of the things we've been talking a lot about today have been the critical priorities facing the incoming Trump administration. You've noted several, but while we see if there are comments or suggestions from the audience, love you to be thinking about if you were ranking the top three, which we've been asking people to do, what those would be.
Rebuild your ability to deter aggression by setting aside sequestration. Sequestration is Latin for doing really dumb things. How we've been able to do this to the discretionary budget and not move the debt needle and call it a success, I'll never know. We're gonna have the smallest army since 1940, the smallest Navy since 1915, the Air Force. Congress will have shot down more fighter planes than any enemy could hope to do through sequestration. But when we replace it, I hope we'll look at what defense really means. If defense doesn't mean the 150 account, you made a huge mistake. Mr. President-elect, you watch a lot of TV in case you're watching this. If you're not willing to invest in the lives of others, you cannot make us safe here. I have come to conclude that. And if you don't believe me, ask any general. General Mattis said, if you cut the State Department's budget, you better buy me more bullets. So get funding right. The Iranian agreement. What keeps me up at night is a nuclear arms race in the Mideast. Does anybody share that concern? How many of you believe the Arabs are going to get a nuclear weapon if they think the Iranians one day will get one? Just talk to the Arabs. The nuclear agreement with the Iranians needs to be renegotiated because at the end of 15 years, they don't even have to cheat. They can reprocess and enrich. We do have more insight into their nuclear program than we did have before. But the $150 billion we gave them in sanctions relief is not building schoolhouses. So what I would do as my number two priority is that I would impose sanctions on the Iranian regime for their behavior outside their nuclear program, for holding hostage American sailors, for toppling four Arab capitals, for supporting Hezbollah, Hamas, and taking Yemen and tearing it apart. We're going to introduce sanctions in a bipartisan fashion to sanction the Iranian regime for their behavior outside the nuclear program. If I were President Trump, I would seize that moment and use it as leverage to get a better deal. The third thing is North Korea. North Korea is an interesting place. The former leader said he had 9 holes in one in his first round of golf. That's when he lost me. Being born in a mountain and all that other stuff, I can go there. We're laughing, but North Korea has nuclear weapons, and they're trying, as I speak, to develop the missile technology to hit our shores. How many of you really want to be president of the United States? So the third thing I would worry about if I were Trump is how do you stop the ICBM program in North Korea? And if you don't stop it, you're going to own the consequences of letting it go forward. So I am going to offer General Mattis Thursday a congressional authorization to use force to stop their ICBM program from hitting the homeland if they want it. And I think every member of Congress should be on the record as to whether or not they support the proposition of using military force, if necessary, to stop the North Koreans from building ICBM that could hit America. Those are the three things I think he needs to really focus on early.
Thank you for that. And we have a questioner right here. Is that Randy?
Sean Callahan, Catholic Relief Services. I appreciate the comments you made, Ms. Senator, regarding the 150 account. Where would you advise the president-elect? What would be his first overseas trip? Why? And what would you have him say?
I'd go to Israel and say, I'm your friend. Then I would go to Jordan and have the King of Jordan host a regional summit and say, I'm your friend. Then I would send a joint message from the Western world and the Arabs to the Iranian people, we want to be your friend. And I'd send a message to the Ayatollah, we've had it with you.
Clear and succinct. Priscilla.
Thank you. I'm Priscilla Clapp. If you were to authorize the use of power on North Korea from the Congress, what kind of reaction do you think it might cause? Would North Korea go after South Korea? Would they start a fight in
That's a really good question.
East Asia?
You know, I advocated leaving troops behind in Iraq. I advocated helping the Free Syrian Army 4 years ago, and I got asked, what would happen if you did? Well, there would be a consequence to helping people who are fighting for their freedom. I realized that if you adopt my foreign policy views, that there will be consequences. I've sat down and thought, what's the worst thing that can happen? The worst thing can happen is if North Korea actually builds a missile that can hit our homeland. And I work backward. The worst thing can happen in Syria is for Russia and Iran to come bail Assad out after we told him he had to go. The worst thing that can happen for America is when you tell North Korea it's not going to happen, and it happens. So Trump has tweeted himself into a red line here. Should he have done it? I don't know. I wouldn't have done it that way. I'm glad I don't email or tweet. I would have told the Chinese what my red lines were. And you tell North Korea, if you do these things, all bets are off. That's the way I would have done it. But we're now out there where we're publicly saying we're not going to let North Korea build an ICBM. Here's what I think would happen. If they believed Trump was serious about it, they would find a way to stand down. Because let me tell you this, as bad as a war with North Korea would be, I know who's going to lose it. They will. As bad as a war with Iran would be, I know who would lose it. They will. And you know what? They know that too. Interesting times, isn't it? You got a real crazy guy wanting to build a missile to hit your homeland with like 100 weapons. I mean, what do you do about it?
We have one question. We'll do two more questions over here and then over there.
Thank you. Senator, you have advanced in your comments today. I'm Tamika Tilleman. I direct the Bretton Woods II program at New America, a pretty simple proposition, which is borne out by most of our history. You can either invest now in addressing these market failures, or you can pay later. And what we see at this moment is that those market failures that we're encountering around the world are not only expensive for the U.S. government, they're also very expensive for the private sector in a way that we maybe haven't fully appreciated previously. So I'd be curious to ask your opinion on what, if anything, can be done at a policy level to encourage the private long-term financial actors that will ultimately end up paying a big price if these problems metastasize to start pursuing investments that can address root causes of some of these challenges around the world while hopefully making a return in the process.
Well, Boeing builds 787s in South Carolina. I love Boeing. They're about to sell a bunch of jets to Iran. I know they got Airbus as competition. Tillerson's whole confirmation is going to be about, do you know the difference between being a CEO at Exxon and being Secretary of State? There's one area where I think we can work together with the Russians and the Chinese. The Mideast is seeking nuclear power. Most Arab countries that I've talked to one day would like to have a nuclear program because they'll run out of oil and gas. I am okay with the expansion of nuclear power in the Mideast for peaceful purposes. So Russia, China, and the United States should think about collaborating with our private sectors to basically build nuclear power plants throughout the Mideast as long as we control the fuel cycle. I don't mind Iran having a nuclear power plant. I just don't want people who deny the Holocaust the ability to enrich and reprocess. I don't like the idea that on the day we signed the agreement, that we voted in the Senate on the Iranian nuclear agreement, the Ayatollah said, God willing, in 25 years, Israel won't exist. So the private sector part of this is what the Marshall Plan is all about. You have NGOs, you have big companies doing business all over the world. What if you could take the power of goodness, which is the NGO, the power of capital, which is big business, and marry it up with the power of a government, and put on the table new assistance that reinforces better governance and reinforces outcomes that are more transparent? I know I'm a bit schizophrenic to some of you in this audience. Please understand that I get it when it comes to the limitations of the use of military force in destroying radical Islam. Russia, no one has asked me about Russia. How many of you think Russia hacked into the DNC in Podesta? Me too. How many think we should do something about it? Me too. Now, the president-elect talks all around this. I hope you'll understand that I'm not suggesting that his victory was brought about by Russian interference. You won, Mr. President. Hillary Clinton lost, you won, and it had nothing to do with the Russian hacking. But they did try to interfere. And what I hope he'll understand is that in about 10 days, he's going to be the leader of the free world. And that you have to stop this behavior because it's happening all over the world. He says he wants a better relationship with Russia. How many of you desire that? How can you have a better relationship if they do the same old thing? You're never going to have a better relationship until Russia changes its behavior. You can't have a better relationship with a country whose leader steals his own people blind and kills folks that oppose him and gobbles up their neighbors and tries to break the backbone of democracy, the very foundation of who we are as a people. The only way a better relationship with Russia occurs is when they change, not us forgiving more their bad behavior. So the Congress today introduced sanctions that hit them in the energy sector where they're most vulnerable, that deal with financial services sector. So if you want to do business in Russia, it's going to be harder for you as a private sector company. The reason I did that with nine other Republicans and Democrats is to let Putin know enough is enough, and the current sanction regime is not working. President Trump is going to have to decide how to deal with Russia. I have decided. We're going to deal with Russia from a position of strength. We're going to rebuild our military. We're going to go after him and his cronies for what they did in our election and what they're trying to do throughout the world. I just got back from the Baltic states, where all NATO members were scared to death. I spent New Year's Eve in the Ukraine on the eastern front of the war with Ukrainians who know they're outmanned and outgunned but are willing to die. I'm a hopeless romantic when it comes to democracy, but I'm also very practical. We're dealing with Saudi Arabia. I think they got room for improvement. There are a lot of our allies that we need to push to do better, but you have to deal with the world as it is. The private sector needs to be more utilized in American foreign policy because you bring to the table the essence of America maybe better than any politician. Our ace in the hole is that average people want to be more like us, not less. Our biggest export, movies, entertainment. Never lose sight of the fact that we have an advantage over all enemies. Not because our military is so much better, and it is. It's because most people want what we take for granted. Putin one day will fall, just like all thugs and bullies fall. How much damage between now and then, I don't know. ISIL will be destroyed one day because most mothers and fathers don't want their daughters turned over to these bastards. They just need our help. To our friends in Israel, hang in there. Things are going to get better. My foreign policy is very simple. I believe that what we stand for should be offered to everybody, and if they don't want it, through a free and fair process, I'm okay with that. Trump says America first. I say freedom first. The right of self-determination above all else. And if you vote for a dictator, well, too bad. If most people could vote, they wouldn't accept this. And if you want to be peaceful here, you want to preserve our way of life, you better be involved over there. The only thing I can tell you after 15 years of being at war, we're never going to win this war, all of us staying over here. And the best and the brightest among us are not just our soldiers. It's the people in the State Department and these NGOs who go out and represent American values without carrying a gun. I'm a pretty hawkish guy, but I've had the pleasure of seeing our State Department in action, our NGO community in action, and I believe we would be very wise to invest in them just as we would be wise to invest in our military. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Senator Graham. Let me just say a few words of thanks to you. Thank you, Senator Graham. Thank you for taking time out of such a busy schedule. Thank you for being a starry-eyed pragmatist and a fierce defender of the 150 account. He's got a crazy hearing schedule, so we're very, very appreciative that he was able to join us.